But thanks so much for the kind introduction, and I'd like to start by thanking you all for inviting me. I always really enjoy interacting, especially with young minds like the ones we have on this particular forum. And I've been lucky enough to firsthand engage with IIMA. My family has a long association with IIM Ahmedabad. Have been able to interact with both students and faculty there. And it's great to get a chance to do that with IIMB, and someday hope to come on campus as well. So let me just start.
Kulin, I think we lost you there.
Business and the brand.
Kulin, I think we lost you. I think if you switch off your video for a while, I think the connection should stabilize.
Simple transformations. And whilst we continue to be one of the world's biggest manufacturers in textiles, one of the reinventions started in the 1990s, where my father saw the advent of branded apparel and pivoted the group into the consumer space. So we have been in brands and retail now for 3 decades. I'm very closely involved with that business. So today I'll be talking to you about our consumer business. And Arvind Fashions is around a 4,000 crore brand house. We've had a lot of firsts. We are the guys who brought international brands into India the first time in the 90s. When Arrow came in, we didn't have EBOs back then. There weren't standalone stores. So we've seen the transformation of the Kirana to the store, and the store to the department store, and the department store now to online. So it's been quite a ride. And over the years, we've been lucky enough to build some of India's favorite brands, be it Arrow, US Polo, Tommy, Calvin Klein. So we have an exciting portfolio of brands. And that's what I'll spend a little bit of time talking about. I think this is a incredibly seminal year. I don't know what other word to use for it, but it'll be a year we will remember for a very, very long time as the year that changed so many things. And I think there's so many conversations around what has Corona changed forever and what is temporary. In my view, you know, human behavior doesn't dramatically change permanently. I look at Corona not as a massive reset button, so much so as an accelerator. I think COVID has accelerated dramatically trends which were already in play. So something which would have taken, say, 10 years to play out, possibly will happen in 3. So I like to look at this year as a year which fundamentally changed the gears of transformation. And, you know, I think it's important to understand what this fundamental acceleration is in the consumer business, which we'll talk about today. So if you look at a brands and retail business for hundreds of years, the paradigm of brands and retail experiences has remained very similar, where the entire focus and center of energy has been around the concept.
Kulin,
around the store.
Kulin, I think you're breaking off intermittently. Could I request you to switch off your video, if at all?
2010, that fundamental paradigm has changed.
Yeah. Kulin, can you hear me? Sorry. Your video is breaking off intermittently. Could you switch off your video so that the audio...
Sure.
Is
clear? Sure, I'll do that. That could work. Great, great. Can you hear me better now?
Yeah, much better.
Wonderful. So I think the fundamental thing that digital changed, and it's important to understand this, is that it changed the center of gravity away from the retail store. And the business model of today, the thing right at the center is the consumer. Because, you know, as people which create products and brands, we now can be with the consumer in the palm of the hand on a smartphone 24/7. So fundamentally, the change or the restructuring or the disruption is the move away from the store and to the consumer. And I think it means not just e-commerce. I think anyone who thinks that this is about e-commerce is, I think, missing the larger picture. Because when you change from the store to the consumer being the center of your business model, every aspect of did I break off again?
Yeah, I think you did.
Where did I lose you?
Just the last 30 seconds, I think.
Okay, great. So let me go over it again. I'm really sorry about this. No. What I was saying is that every aspect of our business model has to kind of in the digital world, whether it is the way we market, whether it is about the way we kind of source our products, the way we design, I think everything changes. So what I wanted to kind of emphasize is that even pre-corona, this massive kind of transformation was already underway in our industry. And when it comes to Arvind, you know, we had kind of identified that we'd have to figure out how to ride this disruption. And our journey started around 2012, way before Corona, where the problem statement that we were working on was to say, how do we bring Arvind Fashions into the digital age? And, you know, I had just come back from Harvard Business School, and one of my professors who really had an impact on my way of thinking was a professor named Clay Christensen. He's a person who's built one of the most powerful thought models, I feel, in today's day and age, called Innovator's Dilemma. I'm sure many people on this call would be quite familiar. In a nutshell, what Innovator's Dilemma says is disruptions happen because, you know, they sneak in, you know, business models that seem unviable and inferior initially come and compete against you. And slowly and steadily, they keep improving. And before it's too late, the incumbent doesn't know what's hit them. And it's very difficult to take on these disruptions because of a fundamental difference in the way the processes, systems, people, and capabilities to win in these new business models are. So when, you know, we said, how do we take Arvind into digital? The mental model we started saying is it's not about e-commerce. It's all about how do we try and build these capabilities, processes, systems, and people in this completely new digital world. And so we took a very bold call. We said, let's not hire the typical chief transformation officer or chief digital officer, all these fancy terms that are there. I think they are all apple pie. We said, let's build a startup within Arvind and let's attract a different set of people, because fundamentally we are talking about building all the capabilities which are different and we should be ready to disrupt ourselves. So for the first time in our history, we started a startup. We called it Arvind Internet, and we gave it the vision of saying you build an omni stack for the company. We attract the Walmarts, you know, the other great startups we have in India. The average age was 24. We gave ESOPs. Everyone who joined the company owned a part of the company from day one. We had never done that before in Arvind. So we said, let's kind of do something completely different. And what basically we were able to do is bring together very, very interesting people. We were able to give them a walled garden. Define on online, offline. And the customer journey has to be fungible between online and offline. It's that simple. It may sound simple. It's very difficult to do because the retail store, you know, all the KPIs, all the thought processes are around how do you sell things well in a retail store. So we went around, we looked at the existing technology. We realized, you know, nobody has built an omni stack seamlessly for the customer journeys we wanted. So we built our connected every store to become a
Kulin, sorry to interrupt you. I think the video is causing some problems. Losing you intermittently. Can you hear me, Kulin?
Sorry, am I back?
Yeah, I think the video is causing problems, but I mean,
let me switch it off. So we started with this omni-channel, and we initially had so many hiccups. We had cancellations, terrible conversions, but over the years, we kept refining it. Right before COVID, we had achieved a great scale in our omni-channel. We had 80% of our deliveries happening from stores. And we had built a model which was very powerful because when you connect online and offline inventory, you know, you have more demand for the same supply. So you have lower discounting, higher store sales and productivity, lower cost of logistics. So all of that was set up pre-COVID. Things were looking interesting. We felt we were getting into the omni world, and then COVID struck. And I think nothing can prepare a business for 90% sales going away. I mean, there's no management textbook which prepares you for 10% of sales. And I think we had to just go into survival mode. As I look back, one major learning I feel is when you have a crisis of this enormity, the importance of speed, agility, and decisiveness. I mean, I cannot overemphasize how important, and we realize that we'll have to take certain decisions because it's going to be sink or swim. You know, it was a question of survival. First of all, obviously safety. How do we run 1,200 stores without our people contracting COVID? There was a lot of work we had to do on that. Cash, you know, with 90% revenue gone, we had to create a cash war room. We had to attack our costs fundamentally. We cut our quarter one fixed cost by 70%. And, you know, we never thought it's possible, but we had to. Everything had to be restructured. Every single cost head, the way we worked with all our rental partners, everything had to be fundamentally relooked. We shut down 10% of the entire network. Stores which were all on the cusp, we had to take them out. We had to recapitalize the company completely. So in the toughest times when the country was shut, we had to figure out how to bring equity into the company. We brought in 700 crores of equity in the worst phase of the crisis. We signed a very interesting deal with Flipkart, which I will talk about a little later. But again, we were lucky because we had been talking to them for over a year on to how an offline and online company can come together for the world of tomorrow. So we were able to close that deal in the middle of the COVID crisis. And we started our strong doubling down or pivot on digital. And that comes to the topic of conversation today that, you know, we had last 5 years worked hard to create the omni stack and prepare ourselves. And now, you know, rubber hit the road. You know, this was our demonetization moment of omni channel in a sense, because online was really the only show in town. And we were lucky that we had the basic platform, but this is what we did as soon as COVID hit to really double down on digital. The first thing is on our own .com, we had now.com, which had just about hit positive unit economics. And post-COVID, we saw a huge surge in a lot of new customers coming in on digital. So we went in and we saw that we have so many loyal customers who cannot come to our stores. How do we make them shop with us? So we used a lot of great personalized campaigns through WhatsApp, through SMSs, through social. We took our entire 10 million base of loyal customers and we used all that rich data to target all our customers to shop with us online. And, you know, in a couple of months, we were at 3x level of our run rate before COVID. So it was a huge ramp up. In our stores, we realized, you know, we need to really bring in the store of tomorrow. Already, we were delivering for now.com and we very quickly connected all the third-party marketplaces to our stores. So we connected Flipkart, Amazon, Myntra. We started WhatsApp commerce from our stores. At the peak, I remember in July, we had 35% of our store sales actually being online deliveries. So, you know, the entire store channel was surviving on delivering store orders, I mean, online orders. So, I mean, that really saved us at that point. The third huge transformation was the marketplace model. You know, in the first wave of online, we used to sell in bulk to a Myntra, an Amazon or a Flipkart and then forget about it. The model of tomorrow is marketplace, where it's as good as direct retailing, where we connect our warehouses and stores to online and we actively manage the pricing, merchandising and delivery. That was a huge change. This business, you know, we had a very large business, almost a 600 crore online business last year. So it's not a small business and 100% of it was wholesale. Post-COVID, we have converted 50% of that into marketplace. So it's a massive shift, you know, at certain points we were delivering 100,000 orders a day from our warehouses to the third-party marketplaces. So a huge amount of effort to completely pivot our fulfillment, both from stores and warehouses to do single-piece fulfillment. So that was another huge doubling down we did. Another very, very exciting thing we've worked on is flexible manufacturing. When the world is so volatile, you know, in the old-fashioned cycle, you have autumn, winter, spring, summer. These are all, you know, the old school business models where some guy in France decides which color is in vogue. And then all of us go to this thing called WGSN and then they tell us which colors should be made for the next year. And then we start conceptualizing, designing, sourcing. That entire cycle in the old world was 8 months. We are now working on manufacturing technologies which makes this 8 months go down to 20 days. Let me give you an example. You know, if you make a round neck t-shirt in the old way, it takes 90 days. Our new technology is that we make what we call a blank. We make a blank t-shirt, you know, a red round neck blank t-shirt. And we have digital printing technology that can make a single piece of a design real time. And what we are doing is in the world of digital, we are getting real time feed into what people are buying in different parts of the country. So we, our designers now every month sit, figure out the right trend, use this data, decide which round necks to make. All the blanks are ready. We make 50 of each, upload them on marketplace, start selling. We get an idea of the feed, the read, the rate of sale, and then we produce in bulk. So this is what I mean by digitizing the entire supply chain. It's not just about e-commerce. It's about how do you make the entire supply chain agile? And then coming to you know, collaborations, I feel the world of tomorrow is going to be a complete merger between online and offline. And as we started thinking about that, we realized that we'll never be able to create the access and the supply chain and the logistics infrastructure of the large online players. At the same time, you know, they will in brands as well as we can. So the thought was, can we bring those worlds together? And when, you know, the leadership at our end and Flipkart sat down, we said, why not try this in a novel way where we join hands and co-own a brand? So we took one of our most exciting youth brands, Flying Machine, and we may put it into a joint venture with Flipkart with a very exciting mandate of saying, can we create tomorrow's digital-centric youth brand? Which is saying, let's use their access, let's use their big data and analytics, let's figure out who is buying where, and then let's marry it to one of our cool brands with this flexible supply chain. And let's disruptively create products for the online channel. So from the world of selling our offline products online. We will move into a world of creating product for the digital native, with online as the main focus, and offline will be an add-on. And the whole idea would be, can we 2x, this is a 500 crore brand, can we 2x in 3 years? These are kind of growth rates we can never imagine in the offline world. But in the online world, you know, we'll be launching 5 new categories. I mean, in this BBD, we sold some 50,000 women's wear jeans, and our brand isn't even a women's brand. So these are the kind of disruptive things that are possible, you know, when you can bring the strength of online and offline together. And with, you know, we also brought in a lot of new product categories we didn't have. Open slippers became a huge thing because of work from home. Chappals were selling at like unimaginable rates in India. We never made them. In a couple of months, we designed them, and we are selling, I think, 100,000 a month now. Athleisure, a new category. Masks became a huge category. So the reason I'm giving all these examples is, I think being extremely nimble and opportunistic when you are a 10% revenue business is the only way you survive. And net, by quarter two, we recovered to 50% of last year's sale. As we have come to Diwali, we've come back to 80%. And an interesting statistic is, with all of these digital initiatives in quarter two, 50% of our revenue was digital, from 15 to 50. So a lot of hard work. I think we were fortunate that we had laid the framework beforehand, but a lot of doubling down and hard work post-COVID could help us make this happen. I'll just quickly touch on some implications I'm seeing going forward, and then I wanted to open it up. What do I see as things that will remain and which are very critical moving forward? I think moving forward, companies will have to invest more and more on the digital side. Even if I look at my company, 70% of our resources are still in offline. We're overspecked in offline and underspecked in online. I think everyone will have to completely change that, and we'll have to invest more. We're still at the beginning of the personalization and the cognitive revolution in our industry. Our omni-channel journeys are still underdeveloped. We're not developing enough digital content. So a lot more, you know, we've cracked one inventory, but I think the future is one customer. So a lot more investments to be done there. The store is no longer going to be a sales medium. It's going to be an experience medium. We'll have fewer and fewer stores in big towns. But those stores which we will have will be lighthouse stores. They'll be iconic. You'll come in, you'll be able to co-create some products. You will have digital clienteling. People will give you personalized recommendations. So the store will become more fun. Otherwise, honestly, there's no role for the store. The store creates the emotional connect. It's not meant for sales anymore. The growth in stores will come from small towns, is my belief. You know, India, our brands still have 300 stores. If you look at a Chinese brand, it has 3,000 stores. And that's because China has standalone stores in 1,500 towns. We still have it in 100 towns. So a lot of more expansion into small towns on the physical side. I think supply chain will dramatically change. Any company doing an 8-month concept to shelf is going to get disrupted. It will be fossilized soon. So we'll have to move into 1 month and below flexible just in time, especially for the online business. I think online can be a negative working capital business moving forward. Alliances and partnerships are going to be critical. You will see more and more of them happening. All of you have been reading in the newspaper. An offline and online partnership is almost coming once a month in our industry now. You will see many more of these alignments between the large online companies and the large offline companies like ourselves. And I think it's going to get harder and harder to make brands relevant. I think loyalty is going to be harder and harder to get from the consumer. They have more and more choice, and authenticity matters. So brands will have to double down on product and experience. Storytelling will have to be authentic, and brands will need to be clear on what they stand for. Doing everything for everybody and not doing it well will really cost. So as the barrier to entry of creating coolness goes up, I think it's going to be harder and harder to keep brands cool. So these are some of the things that trends that I am seeing. But I think whilst it's been an incredibly hard year, I think we've all aged a decade trying to survive this year. But I think if you just step back, the India story is just starting. I mean, we are at the beginning of the S curve. Our largest apparel brands are 1,000 crores. In China, the largest local apparel brand would be $3 billion. This is just one brand. So I think just the sheer scale of what is to come as middle income India scales up. And with the youth and the digital being so fast paced in India, I think you'll see so many new business models. Social commerce is just starting off. We will go the China way and not the US way. You'll see so many new business models emerging from the fashion side over the years to come. And I think new categories will also emerge. India is barely using cosmetics. We are barely using fashion accessories. Our wellness sector has not even taken off. Active is still very small. So a lot of new exciting spaces in the Indian consumption story. And I think the guys who will win are the guys who can reinvent. You know, business models used to change every 15 years. Now they change every 5. So constant reinvention and innovation. How do you attract the right talent? I mean, we are a talent deprived country. We have far less talented people or, you know, trained people than we need. So the companies that attract the best talent are the ones which will win. And of course, making the right bets, which involves what to put resources behind and what not to do, more importantly. So I think each bet will count more. So I think we'll have to be very careful where we make bets in times to come. So that's a very quick opening comment from my side. Would love to answer questions and talk about any of these topics which I've covered.